Hi everyone, this is the second lecture of internal combustion engines. In first lecture we have discussed about history of IC engines, who has invented IC engines and how the developments are carried out, and then we have seen about classifications of IC engines or different types of IC engines. So if you have not gone through this video, then please go through it. The link is there in the description, or by clicking on above I link you can get access to it. And in this lecture we'll first discuss about introduction or terminology of IC engine, so that you'll be able to identify the basic parts of IC engine. Then we'll move towards different parts of internal combustion engines, different functions of these parts and which materials are used in order to manufacture these parts. So we'll first discuss about introduction or terminology of internal combustion engines. For that we have to consider this sketch, this diagram. So this is the important components of internal combustion engines. So for the sake of simplicity and understanding, we'll draw the engine in this way, right? So the practical engine is completely different. So I would like to make it a little bit 3D. So the engine will look like this one, right? Here you'll be able to observe the components. See, these are the major components of internal combustion engines. See, the combustion is carried out inside this is a cylinder, this is the engine cylinder, in which this piston is attached, or piston will reciprocate. See, the combustion will be taken place here in this portion, right? So when the heat energy or when the combustion will take place here, the piston will move up and down, the fuel will be entered through the cylinder through these walls. One is inlet wall and one is outlet wall. This wall will be connected, outlet wall will be connected to the silencer or exhaust, and the inlet wall is connected to the fuel tank. So this is what a little bit 3D model of engine. And if you think in practical, then we'll make this engine in this way. So this is the practical engine, you can observe this. But for the sake of simplicity and understanding, so we will consider this type of sketch to explain different parameters. So you have to be understand that the actual engine is little bit different. See, this is the actual engine and this is what the engine you will study. But you should be able to imagine, if this is the piston I am talking about, then actual piston is in this way, which is mounted inside the cylinder. This is a cylinder, so this is the actual cylinder, right? There are many more components that the IC engine is consisting of. So in today's lecture we'll be explaining all these components. What are these parts, what these parts are meant for, what are the purpose of individual part. Likewise, here you can see this is the piston. This piston is attached to this shaft, it is called as connecting shaft. Now let's understand about this basic concept, what these points mean for. So we'll just go one by one. We'll consider this 2D sketch to explain these parameters. See, one important parameter is TDC. As in this diagram also you'll be able to see, this is TDC, means top dead center. See, top dead center is the uppermost position of this piston. Piston cannot move up beyond this limit. So TDC is nothing but top dead center. One more term, BDC. So BDC is the bottom dead center. This is the maximum position till the piston will come down, right? So this is the minimum position of the piston. This is the maximum or uppermost position of the piston. And the distance between them can be called as stroke. See, stroke is nothing but the movement of piston in cylinder between TDC and BDC. This is a cylinder, this is the piston. As we talked about, this is inlet manifold which is attached to fuel tank, right? This is exhaust manifold which is attached to silencer. This is clearance volume. See, this volume is nothing but clearance volume. Basically there are three types of volumes as far as the engine is concerned. This is clearance volume, I can call this as VC. then this is the total volume, this is the total volume Vt, and one more volume is there which is in between this point and this point. This is called as swept volume Vs. So I repeat, there are three types of volumes engine is consisting of. This is a clearance volume where combustion is carried out, it can be called as Vc. Then second is total volume from this point to this point, it is total volume. And swept volume Vs, swept volume is the volume swept by piston when moving from TDC to BDC. Bore diameter, see the diameter of this engine is nothing but bore or bore diameter. The next component is revolution. It is a simple term. Revolution is nothing but crankshaft rotation. When the piston will moves down, then the crankshaft will be rotated with 180 degrees. When again will the piston, when the piston moves up, then again this crankshaft will be rotated with 180 degrees and one rotation will be completed, and that can be called as revolution, one revolution. Displacement is also related to the stroke, or displacement volume we can say, the volume swept by the engine when it moves from TDC to BDC, this volume displacement. Cycle, friends, about this part we'll be talking about in the next lecture, third lecture. But a cycle means basically the engine is running with the help of important strokes that we can call as suction stroke, compression stroke, power stroke and exhaust. So the engine will start when the fuel will be entered, the fuel will be entered in the engine. So this is first stroke, suction stroke, right? Then this piston will move up, this fuel will be compressed, second stroke. Then in case of spark engine, sparking will be taken place and this combustion fuel will be ignited, that is power stroke, third stroke, and then the gases will be escaped out through the exhaust valve, this is fourth stroke. And this can be called as complete one cycle. When exhaust, at the end of exhaust stroke, inlet valve will open and again suction stroke will start. Again second cycle will start. So this cycle continues in order to run the engine. So we'll be talking about this in next lecture in detail. Compression ratio, this is again one of the most important term in the IC engine. Compression ratios are more in case of diesel engines, as to self-ignite the diesel engine, compression ratios are more. But in case of petrol engines, spark is there, so the compression ratios are less as compared to diesel engine. And there are other two important terms like octane rating and cetane rating. Due to that, in case of petrol engine, we cannot increase compression ratios, but in case of diesel engine, it is possible to increase compression ratios. See, the compression ratios is nothing but it is a ratio of volume, total volume divided by small volume. See, as we have discussed here, this is a total volume. So this volume is a total volume divided by smallest volume is a clearance volume. So we can better understand with this formula. See, this is the formula, total volume of cylinder. See, this is the volume, this is the total volume. So this volume divided by clearance volume, this is the clearance volume. So this is nothing but compression ratios. Swept volume, see, swept volume is nothing but cc, or we can call this as cubic centimeter, right? More is the cc, we know that power is more, and definitely the size of engine is more. So how the cc of that particular engine can be calculated? We know that there are different types of cars are available in the market. We have heard about, for example, we have heard about Maruti 800 car. So the cc of that car is 800, means the cylinder capacity, the volume of that engine is 800 cubic centimeter. So in order to find out this swept volume, we can see in order to find out the volume swept, swept volume is this volume, the volume swept by the piston from moving TDC to BDC. So this volume is nothing but swept volume. So how to find out this volume? So we should know the area of this area. There will be piston area. This is a piston, and piston area into this length, stroke length. This is TDC, this is BDC, right? So to calculate volume, I have to multiply this area with this length so that I will get the volume. Likewise, if you know the bore, see, cylinder area, to calculate cylinder area, we can consider this formula, pi by 4 divided by d square. This d is nothing but bore diameter. So if you know the bore diameter of any engine, you will calculate the cc for that particular engine. We know that there is one company, Rolls-Royce, and one of its model having cc of around 6500, and that car can be used for racing purposes. So you can imagine the regular cars that we use having the cc of around 1000 to 2000, but the sports car having, or the racing cars are having, cc's above 5000 even. See, for that you have to go through one exercise. See, you have to compare the specifications to get a better understanding into all these parameters. You have to compare the specifications of at least 5 cars engines of your choice. You have to selected 5 cars, those are available in the market, and you have to compare the specifications of engines. How much BHP is there, what is the CC of that particular car, what are the difference efficiencies, etc. Then you will get a better understanding about this parameter that we talked about. So friends, this was the basic terminology of internal combustion engines, and now we'll move towards different parts of ICE engine. But prior to that, I would like to show you an animation. Please go through it and then we'll get back to different parts of internal combustion engines. Please watch this animation carefully so that you will get better understanding about different parts of ICE engines and how these parts are assembled. So this is the block of ICE engine, and then this is the crankshaft which will be attached with this connecting rod and piston. These are the piston pins. As this is a 4-cylinder engine, four pistons are there. They are inserted into the engine block. And this is a flywheel which is attached to it. Then there is one more component which is called as cylinder head, which is just placed on the cylinder. These are the valves, opening and closing valve, through which fuel is sucked inside the cylinder and exhaust gases escaped out. This is placed on the cylinder. With the help of this bolt, it is attached to it. So there are hundreds of parts that the IC engine is having, but in this video we are going to discuss few important parts. So this is the timing chain which is attached to the camshaft and crankshaft. So this is the cover, cylinder head cover. These are again attached with the help of bolts, and this is the oil sump, or we can say this is a crankcase. When we change oils from the vehicle or engine, this will be replaced with the help of new oil. See, these are the inlet pipes through which fuel from fuel tank will be entered in the cylinders. Those are indicated with this black color. There are many seals are there in the engine to avoid leakage. Battery, starter and alternator are also fitted to it. And they are fastened with the help of bolts to the casing. This is the casing. This is the starter coils. These are the exhaust pipes through which gases will be escaped out in the atmosphere. Or we can say silencer, it is attached to silencer. So this is how the engine works. This is the four cylinder engine, and the reason that you are able to see four pistons are moving. See, observe the movements of pistons. Piston moves up and down, but it converts rotary motion with the help of crankshaft. See, piston reciprocates, and the flywheel, this is a bigger size, it is called as flywheel. So reciprocating motion is converted into rotary motion. See, this is the crankshaft. How, observe this, how the inlet wall is opened, how the combustion is taken place, and piston is forced downwards. Again, it comes upward. So this process or these cycles continues. Inlet, compression, exhaust, inlet, compression, power, exhaust. These four strokes are carried out simultaneously, and this is how the engine works. You can observe this camshaft, movement of camshaft. With the help of this camshaft, these walls are opened and closed. This timing has been set with the help of timing chain. See, this is the general phenomena how the engine works, and now we'll move towards different parts of IC engine. Now we'll start to discuss different IC engine parts and their materials. With this video or animation that we gone through, you have got basic idea about the number of parts. There are hundreds of parts, but we are going to discuss important parts and their materials. So this is the exploded view of internal combustion engines. This we already discussed. See, this is the most important part as far as IC engine is concerned. This can be called as cylinder block. This is cylinder block head, and this is cover, or cylinder block head cover, and this part can be called as oil sump or crankcase. These are the major parts, and one more important part is there, which we can call as piston. Those pistons, see here, you'll get an idea about this engine. You'll find four cylinder blocks are there. One cylinder block is there, but there are four cylinder inside it. So it does mean that this is a four cylinder engine which will be having four pistons fitted into it. So this is a four cylinder engine, and these different parts are attached with the help of these gaskets. These are the gaskets. Gaskets helps to avoid leakage. And we'll be having this manifolds, exhaust manifolds, intake manifolds, etc. So let's go one by one. Cylinder block. As I talked about, cylinder block is most important component of internal combustion engine. So this is the cylinder block. You have to observe this. So very small holes, intricate shapes are there. And due to that, cylinder head is always manufactured with the help of casting process. Only casting process it is possible to manufacture cylinder block. So see, this cylinder, as you can see here, it is fitted with the piston. The piston will be there inside the cylinder block, and you will find that this is a six cylinder engine. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So six pistons will be fitted into it. And on this cylinder block, cylinder head is fitted, and this side of cylinder block will be fitted with crankcase or oil sump. Here will be find oil sump, and here will be find cylinder head. See, mostly nowadays cast iron is used to manufacture cylinder blocks, but right now advancements are carried out, and aluminium alloy come in picture. And most of the cars will be manufactured with aluminium alloy cylinder block. See, still there are few heavy duty diesel vehicles are manufactured with cylinder block. There are many advantages as we have mentioned here. Due to that, cast iron is used. The most important advantage is this advantage. It is very simple to cast in intricate shapes. And that is the ultimate purpose of this. You will find very small holes and complex parts need to be imposed into it. And for that, it is very simple to cast. And that for that purpose, cast iron is used. Aluminium alloy is also, nowadays it is possible to cast in intricate shapes, but it becomes costlier. The setup becomes costlier as compared to cast iron. Cast iron strength, wear strength is also excellent. Corrosion resistance, and the most important thing is excellent vibrational damping capacity. There are two disadvantages as far as cylinder, cast iron cylinder blocks are concerned. See, it tends to boil or when placed under heavy loads. Thermal conductivity of cast irons is less as compared to aluminium alloy, because due to the heavy loads, cast iron tends to boil, and due to that, maybe this internal portion of this cylinder will be distorted. And the second reason is engine is heavy as compared to aluminium alloy. Weight of the cast iron is more and engine becomes heavy. And if you talked about aluminium alloy, then the most efficient and better property is thermally efficient or better thermal conductivity. Engine is lighter. Negative temperature coefficient. This is again for engine purpose. This is the most important parameter. It is having negative temperature coefficient. Means when the load of engine will be increased, the temperature in this surface, see, the temperature in this engine cylinder will increase. And when the temperature will increase, this material will dissipate heat very fast, unlike cast iron, right? But in cast iron, if the temperature is increased due to load, then this portion will be distorted. The heat will not be passed to the water jacket. See, these are the water jackets. This is the major advantage of aluminium alloys. And we know that just outside of this cylinder, water jackets are placed. We know that there is one component in the engine which can be called as radiator. So we fill up this radiator with the help of water, and that water is circulated through these water jackets. And again, this will be passed to the radiator where fans are attached. With the help of those fans, this water will be cooled and again it is recirculated. In this way, the heat will be carried away in cooling water. The second important component is cylinder head or cylinder cover. See, this cylinder head will be placed on the cylinder block that we have discussed. The important function of this cylinder head is to house the exhaust and intake valves. You can see here. See, these are the valves, inlet and exhaust valves. And this is the camshaft attached. These are the push rods. And these are the rocker arms. These are the three important part that the cylinder head is having. And just above the cylinder head, we place cylinder cover. Materials used is aluminium alloy is used to house these different parts. Piston. See, piston is again the most important part who has to sustain very high thermal pressure. When the combustion will be carried out, high thermal energy will be impacted on this top surface. You have to observe this top surface of this piston. It comes in conical forms. This is not a straight, this is a conical form. And the main function of the piston is to reciprocate inside the cylinder. When the combustion will be taken place, piston will move down, then it will move up. And this piston, with the help of this piston pin, it can be called as gajah pin. With the help of this pin, this piston is attached to the connecting rod. See, here you can observe this. This is a piston these are the piston rings. See, these are the piston rings, and this is a connecting rod. This is a small end of connecting rod. With the help of this pin, this small end will be attached here, and this is the big end of connecting rod, which is attached to crankshaft. Material used is aluminium alloy for external excellent thermal conductivity and lightweight. Piston rings. See, piston rings plays a very important role as far as engine is concerned. You can see here, this is the interface which indicates piston rings. Maybe there will be 3 to 4 piston rings in every engine. The purpose is, piston rings maintains compression in between piston and cylinder, right? There will be few compression rings. Piston rings can be classified into compression rings and oil rings. There will be number of compression rings and there will be one oil ring. See, we know that the piston always reciprocates in between or in cylinder block. It moves down, moves up. So the sliding will be taken place in this interface. So to maintain proper sliding or contact of sliding, oil has to be passed in between this interface, right? But the compression spring are used, and here you will find this is oil ring. So oil ring, see, here the sump will be mounted, or oil from this sump will be pumped through this oil ring, right? This a part of this oil will be used to slide the piston in between this interface, and remaining oil will be again comes in this oil sump, right? See, the major purpose of this compression ring is to maintain compression, and the second is to avoid these oils to be entered into this combustion chamber. If this oil is entering into the combustion chamber, if it is mixing with the fuel, then the efficiency of engine will be reduced, power of engine will be reduced. So for that purpose, compression springs are there and oil spring is there. One more important function of these compression rings are, they are transferring the heat which is acted on the piston to the cylinder and to the water jackets. This is again the most important function of the compression rings. See, these are the rings. This will be the rings. We'll be having a different design, and the material used is cast iron of fine grain. See, elasticity is very important as far as these rings are concerned, and cast iron of fine grain is used because it retains integrity of original shape. It is again due to elasticity. Connecting rod. It is a simple component which is machined from billet. Right, and material used is low carbon steel because it is having excellent machinability and strength also. So this is a big end of connecting rod. This is a small end which is attached to piston, and big end is attached to crankshaft. So this is the crankshaft. So crankshaft is attached to the flywheel on this end, right? See, the reciprocating movement of piston, big end of connecting rod would be attached here at crank pin. This will be the connecting rod attached to the piston, and this is the engine block. When the piston reciprocates, reciprocating motion of this piston will be transferred into rotary motion of this crankshaft. As soon as the crankshaft will start rotating, this flywheel will rotate. So the flywheel will store the energy, and again this flywheel is attached to the clutch. It will again attach to the gearbox, and through gearbox it is attached to the axles, and through axles it is attached to the wheels. Likewise, the power is transferred. And to manufacture the crankshaft also, either forged steel is used or cast iron is used. If we are manufacturing the crankshaft for low load vehicles, then we can use basically this material, nodular cast iron, or otherwise we can go for forged crankshafts or forged steel material. Then flywheel. See, flywheel is again very important as far as engine is concerned. See, there will be fluctuation in the combustion process in the engine. That sometimes, see, when the combustion will be carried out, it suddenly presses the piston downwards, right? So these fluctuations will be absorbed by the flywheel, and we'll be observing that the vehicle is running with the steady speed. We do not observe any fluctuation, and this is because of this flywheel. This flywheel stores energy, and as soon as the application needs it, then the energy or speeds will be transferred to the wheels slowly. See, flywheel keeps the crankshaft rotating at uniform speed even though there are different fluctuations, and materials used is cast iron. So crankcase. So basically crank is mounted in this case, and fuel oil is also mounted just below this portion, and that is the ultimate aim of the crankcase. It is made up of cast iron. Poppet valve. See, simple inlet and outlet valves can be called as poppet valves, and the material used is phosphorus bronze and monel metal. Spark plug. High intensity spark is needed in case of petrol engine in order to ignite the fuel. Engine bearings. There are different types of bearings mounted here. You can see with the help of yellow color the bearings have indicated. There are different types of bearings used. Here the bearing is used, here bearing is used, right? The main bearing, this can be called as main bearing, this bearing and this bearing, which is, these are the main bearings. With the help of these bearings, see, this is attached with this casing. This shaft is rotating, but this is stationary casing. So this is possible with the help of these bearings. Governor. Again, the governor is a component which is used to reduce the fluctuations. So for example, if loads on the vehicles increase, then definitely the speed will be reduced. But in order to equalize the speed, see, the governor operates, and governor opens inlet valve through which required fuel is injected in the cylinder, and the speed is equalized. As you can see here, the function of governor is to control fluctuations of engine speed. See, carburetor is basically used in petrol engines. The concept of carburetor is right now left behind, and we are using fuel injection systems. So the simple purpose of carburetor is to supply proper mixture of air and fuel, to supply proper mixture of petrol and air, and that is the ultimate purpose of the carburetor. See, this is the throttle valve which is attached to accelerator pedal. It is attached to accelerator pedal, and when we press the accelerator pedal, this valve will open, and this will allow air to come inside. And as the air will come inside, see, this area is reduced, and as a result of it, suction will be created here in this portion, and for that suction the fuel will be sucked inside, and these droplets mixes with the air, and this mixture will be supplied to the engine. So to supply proper air fuel ratio, carburetor is needed in case of petrol engines. Fuel atomizer or injector. In case of diesel engine, basically we need fuel atomizer or injectors. See, atomizers, what is atomization? See, breaking the liquid fuel into droplets, it can be called as atomization, and it is really important to atomize the fuel to go for complete combustion or proper combustion. So you can observe here, this is the atomized fuel. This is high pressurized fuel will be injected in the cylinder so that it is, the proper atomization is taken place. See, this is the actual part, how the injector looks like. Manifold. We know that there are basically two types of manifolds are there. Inlet manifold and exhaust manifold. See, this is inlet manifold and this is exhaust manifold. material used is aluminium alloy. See, these inlet manifolds are attached to the fuel tank. The fuel is passed through these inlet manifolds to the cylinders, and then when combustion is taken place, exhaust gases are escaped out through this. This is connected to the silencer. Gauge pin, as we talked about, gauge pin or piston pin is help to connect piston to the connecting rod. See, this is small end of connecting rod. Plain carbon steel is used to manufacture gauge pin. Push rods, see, push rods are necessary when this camshaft is mounted at lower side. At that case only the push rods are necessary. See, these are the push rods. If this camshaft is mounted here, then we need not to involve these push rods in the engine, right? We can directly attach these rocker arms. These are the rocker arms. We can directly attach rocker arms to the camshaft. So rocker arm, this is a rocker arm. These rocker arms are attached here. Rocker arm helps to presses the spring, and as soon as rocker arm will press the spring, the valves will open and valves will close, and the timing of opening and closing of valves will be monitored by this camshaft. So the design of camshaft is very important, and medium carbon steel is used. So camshaft, see, basically there are two shafts. One is crankshaft, one is camshaft. Camshaft is basically mounted in cylinder head, and crankshaft is mounted in crankcase. So basically the timing will be maintained by opening and closing timing of valves will be maintained by this camshaft. So this is cam heel, cam journal, journal bearings, and one side of this camshaft is connected to the crankshaft through chain in order to decide the proper timing of that engine. So here you can observe how the camshaft and crankshafts are mounted. You can observe here, see, these are the camshafts and these are the crankshafts. So with the help of chain, timing chain, we attached camshaft and crankshaft so that movement of this, rotational movement of this crankshaft will be sensed by the camshaft, and accordingly opening and closing timings of these valves will be decided. And gasket, the last component, which is gasket. See, gasket is very important as far as the engine is concerned. In some cases we observe oil escapes out of the engine, and on outer surface of the engine or casing we experience oil, and this is because when the gasket fails. So the gasket is basically placed in between different components, like in between cylinder head, cylinder block, and gasket prevents leakage. For that, gaskets are very important, and gasket also withstand high pressure and high temperature. So accordingly the material selected and the gaskets are designed. So I hope you like this information and video. If you do have any questions, please write me in the comment box. I will try to answer all these questions. So we'll see you in my next video. Bye bye.